Welcome, everybody. Summer's drawing to a close. Our last two McCloskey speaker series are the Democratic governors. Next Tuesday, the Republican governors. For better or worse, we now have the two best of our panel of governors, the other two being under the weather. Jay Inslee got quite ill, and John Bel Edwards has a different weather issue. If those of us from Louisiana have been following it, the whole state is now underwater. They've closed down Baton Rouge, and it's not even a full hurricane, but it's just a deluge. So he had to get home because there's nothing worse for a governor than to be seen partying in Aspen when you've declared a state of emergency, as he did. So that was it. We'll start with a sartorial question. Is that the way you pronounce it? Which is, show me your socks. Actually, I don't have any.
So I have on my, these are mine.
For those who can't see it, Donald, well, let's get a close up. I guess I should do introductions. That, as you know, was Governor John Hickenlooper, a former bar owner, which explains a lot. But now, the great governor, a great friend of the Institute, for which thanks, and Governor Dan Malloy of Connecticut, who, among other things, is the chairman of the Democratic Governors Association and helped bring this here. So thank you for being here, and thank you for doing this. And speaking of your socks, let's start without trying to get too political in presidential politics, but explain the phenomenon that's happening this year that's causing such an anger, such a disaffection, causing the Trump phenomenon, and perhaps even the Bernie Sanders phenomenon.
Well, I think certainly they're related. In a funny way, they're almost two sides of the same coin. And I think it's, as is often the case, this is a phenomenon that's a result of several social currents and social factors. One is that for the last 12 or 14 years, we've had such amazing technology innovations that have occurred so rapidly and been accompanied by business innovations. So, I mean, one good example is Uber, right? Suddenly a whole, these professions, not just people losing their jobs, they're losing their careers. And it sort of started with outsourcing. And so a lot of the manufacturing capacity of the country was moved over to the Far East. And then even the local jobs now have been, those professions have disappeared again and again. And when people who've lost their whole careers, and so maybe they find another job, and instead of making 40 grand a year, they're now making, you know, $24,000 a year, and they have less benefits. And they see, from their point of view, the people that are getting all the help are the people on Medicaid, the really low-income folks. They're getting help from government. And then the very wealthy people seem to be getting tax breaks, and Wall Street seems to get bailed out. And I think it is that has created an anger for both Republicans and Democrats. But that and it's a funny thing. You know, I got laid off in 1986. I was a geologist. I came out here. And that was, an eight-year, nine-year wage. I mean, it was just a very hard time for wages and all kinds of, not just oil and gas, but when I got laid off in 1986, I was out of work for better than 2 years. And after about 9 months or 10 months, when you look in the mirror, you see a different person than who you used to see. And it's almost unavoidable. I was an optimistic person. You know, I would begin to doubt some of the things I had always held as kind of core values of who I was. Mm-hmm. And I think that's been going on at a level that no one has really appreciated until Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders, I think, gave voice. And they view immigrants as taking a lot of those jobs and pushing people into these, you know, less attractive and lower paid careers. When I was campaigning for re-election, I met several people. I met three people who had commercial painting companies who had lost, they'd had their businesses for over 20 years. All three of them had gone bankrupt because they would not hire undocumented workers, and so they could not compete with other companies. And it, I tell you, it makes you sick at your stomach. And this notion, I certainly think that we have to, you know, we're not going to expel 11 million immigrants, but we need to secure the borders of this country. And I think, you know, there's a level of anger about that that's well placed. So, and let me just, that last part of the last time we had this level of job displacement at this scale for this period of time was really back to the, like, 1920, 1918, right after World War I, where they electrified factories. And I'd never really appreciated how much, instead of factories and mills being out by the old mill stream in a kind of a rural setting, they actually came into cities and towns, and you get much more density. It allowed the workforce to be much more efficient. And all of a sudden, Henry Ford and others created the assembly line. There were business innovations. And people lost jobs and whole careers at an unprecedented rate back then. And think about it. Remember the anarchy and the anarchists and the Wobblies and all the labor strife and then the Great Depression for 10 years? I mean, that was a very difficult time as well. And I think we're going through that same level of social anger and frustration at all this job loss.
And Governor Malloy, you've been taking a strong stance on refugees, not quite the same as the immigration issue. But do you see a pushback, anger there, or how do you look at that?
Yeah, let me touch that in one second. You were born in Pennsylvania, and you were educated in Connecticut. You should remember that the assembly line was invented in Hartford, Connecticut by Samuel Colt.
I can't believe I forgot to say that, but I thought we weren't talking about Colt anymore.
50 years before Ford did it, so I just, I want to go on record. Right. I'm proud of my state. Yeah. So I agree with absolutely everything that my good friend, and we are good friends and have known each other for a long period of time, has said. With the proviso that, you know, we are still involved in the longest war that America's ever been involved in, and people don't see an end really coming about, and so that causes its set of frustrations. I would argue that if the job growth or recovery that we've seen in jobs nationally had been accompanied by a increase in wages, that we wouldn't be in the same situation we're in as well. You create 14 million good-paying jobs, and people are going to be pretty happy. But if you create 14 million jobs that pay people less than their predecessor a job, then you're going to have trouble. And a lot of that is the resentment, I think, of lower cost assembly and manufacturing. And then I think that there's one other thing that I would say that plays into this in the United States, and that is that you know, for the better part of 40 years, we have underinvested in infrastructure in the United States, and that's playing itself out. The frustration that urban dwellers live with on a transportation basis, or rural folks have, or the inability to use the internet still in substantial portions of our country. All of these things get together and cause this frustration. And then what you need is somebody to light a match. And clearly, we have at least one person who's not afraid to yell fire anywhere. And so I think that there really is a combination of issues that are playing into this. Some of that does not explain the youth disaffection. And I think that it's going to take another 12 months to 18 months to fully understand, because I think there's been less work done understanding their level of disaffection, as opposed to, well, I've won two close elections in Connecticut to be governor, and I sometimes joke that the only middle-aged white men who voted for me were my brothers and myself. Yeah. We know a little bit more about that group than we do some others.
Mm-hmm. But how do you see the refugee immigration issue affecting Connecticut? And then
we go back to the refugee. I'm sorry. I think there's a couple of stories to be told about this. I think the refugee issue is highly politically exploitable. So last November, one governor, following the murders in Paris, one governor. Governor from Michigan said, I'm not going to accept any Syrian refugees. And within 24 hours, 31 governors in the United States had signed on to that agreement. And that's a scary proposition in the United States, I think. It allows people to just play on people's ignorance. The most vetted people in America who want to come to America are refugees. The process is 18 to 2.5 years, 18 months to 2.5 years. There's more interviews, there's more cross interviews, there's separating of spouses and children and interviews and background material. I mean, they're really, when you think about how easy it is to travel to the United States with or without a visa, depending on where you're coming from, and remember that the folks who've done most of the killing in Brussels and in Paris were actually citizens of those countries. All of those citizens could come here at any moment without a visa, and you were going to pick on a group that's as well vetted as possible is a scary proposition. And then if you think about a United States that would abrogate all of its international agreements going back to 1951 in the aftermath of the failure to appropriately resettle dispossessed individuals from the Second World War, we entered into those agreements and we're going to throw them away because some governor in Michigan had what he thought was a cute idea.
Mm-hmm. Governor Hickenlooper, there's probably few states that benefit. Thank you. There are probably few states that benefit as much from trade as Colorado. I mean, you're part of the global economy. And yet there's also a huge pushback on trade. How do you think Democrats either are to make the case for free trade or back away from the case and say that it has disrupted too many jobs and we have to focus on that?
But first, before I answer that, I do want to make sure that everybody knows that Governor Malloy was recently awarded. No, he won the John F. Kennedy Profiles in Courage Award this year for his work with Syrian
refugees. For the
refugees.
Well, yeah. So that's a big award, too.
It's a big deal. It's a really big deal. And, you know, we governors have to make sure, you know, if you call out your own glory, you can always get somebody's attention. But if somebody else is blowing your horn, it carries farther. So I'd like to blow his horn whenever I get a chance. You know, trade is one of those classic things. 20 years ago, pretty much every Democrat was against it. Pretty much every Republican was for it. Now the Republicans are all against it, or most of them, and the majority of Democrats are for it, although being having to rethink that position. But you're right, in Colorado, that benefits significantly from trade and didn't have the old manufacturing that got offshored. There is still this pushback, and I think it's people having a bias, getting kind of swept along in that sentiment that these old agreements like NAFTA were bad for the United States. And I think so far, I haven't seen, I've looked at 5 or 6 different studies, I have not seen anything that's convincing that NAFTA overall wasn't ultimately better for this country. And certainly when you look at global safety, having significant trade with China is as a pathway to global security, you cannot argue that. But the more people are trading together, the more they rely on each other for jobs and income, the less likely they are to pick a fight. You'll have disagreements and you'll have all kinds of conflict, but they won't. You're much less likely to pick up a weapon and start a battle. So, I think what we've been trying to figure out is what are the real facts around NAFTA in terms of job creation, job loss, and really measuring in an honest, objective way. Too many times, both sides tailor the numbers for their argument. So Democrats talk about how many jobs have been created. We don't always talk about the pay because some of those jobs are not as well compensated as the jobs that we used to have. It's also fair to argue, even without NAFTA, how many of those jobs would have been lost anyway? Would have been offshore just because of the improving dynamics or the competitiveness of factory assembly lines in China or even in Mexico, their ability to pay a tariff and still compete successfully. So someone's got to do a study on that in layman's language so we can actually sit down and talk apples to apples and oranges to oranges. But so far, all that's happening is people just shouting what they believe, and everyone doesn't really listen to what anyone else is saying. It's just full of venom. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think all of that is absolutely correct. I think there is a reality that some of our earlier agreements were not as good as they could have been. I think that's particularly true on the environmental side. I think it's true on the wage support side. And so there is some legitimacy to the complaints about those earlier treaties. And then there's this willingness to look at a Pacific agreement without considering the ramifications of leaving it up to the Chinese. And I think that just hasn't been understood in the United States. If we fail to reach it, there are two groups of people trying to capitalize on the failure of that treaty. And that is the folks who are in the United States who are against it, and the Chinese who are hoping that the folks in the United States who are against it, who are against it, will win the argument.
Why don't you bring us another mic, if you would? Yeah, go ahead.
And so I think you have to put that in perspective. The Chinese don't want us to have that agreement. Mm-hmm. Now, could we have a better agreement? Should we have discussions? Is there a way to strengthen it and make it work for more people? I think that's a legitimate discussion to have. It's hard to have such a discussion in the middle of a political campaign where both candidates have stuck out positions that aren't supported.
Donald Trump is coming to Connecticut this week. I mean, who does he appeal to in the state of Connecticut, and why might he think he could win there?
I can't win that argument. If I answer it. I've encouraged the Trump people to spend millions and millions, tens of millions of dollars in Connecticut in an attempt to win this state. I think that would be a wonderful investment on their part. And they shouldn't spend any money in North Carolina. They should spend it all in Connecticut.
Okay.
I don't know where to begin with Donald. I think the worst thing, and there have been some amazingly terrible things to come out of his mouth, but his playing around with a Second Amendment solution is by far the worst thing that any modern candidate of any party running for president has said in multiple generations. I mean, you might have to go all the way back to the know-nothing candidates in the 1840s to find something quite as disturbing as that statement. And to not disavow it immediately, and I understand he doesn't ever want to admit a mistake, because once you start, but I mean, I find it disturbing. And as soon as I heard it, I thought of the situation in Israel in 1995 with Isaac Rabin and ultimately his death. And so that anyone would welcome him to Connecticut, I'm scratching my head.
And it is, I think the something more concerning is the greater question of the Republican Party. And as a Democrat, I'm happy to see the party fracture, right? There's a self-interest there. But as an American, I mean, our system is a two-party system, and it's very hard to evolve away from a two-party system. And I personally feel, I mean, I want to see a Republican Party that works. And right now it's broken. And you have a large chunk of the, and I don't think it's a majority, but I think it's a significant number of Republicans, and a lot of people came in who were independents, and Trump got them fired up, and they participated in the primary. But if he even gets close, and I think this is, you know, some of the journalists are saying the same things. If Trump comes close to winning but fails, we're going to see the same thing in 4 years. And I think there's a legitimate argument, and I'm arguing against my Democratic self, that people should work hard to make sure he loses by a lot and go ahead and fight for Senate Republican seats, Senate for the state senate or the state house, or the U.S. Senate, or the U.S. House, but let him crash in flames, because otherwise we will have a broken Republican Party for who knows how long, and I think that's not good long term. I mean, the Republicans now, they're having a hard time in voting to invest in basic infrastructure. I can't ever remember that happening when I was younger. In the state of Colorado, I can't get a single
well, I got one, but I couldn't get it out of committee. But a single Republican senator, they hold the Senate by one vote, to support a, you know, this would have led to a $230 million a year, 20-year commitment to really solve some of the transportation issues in Colorado. Basic infrastructure. We're not talking about expanding welfare or, you know, doing any of the things that have concerned Republicans in the past. And we couldn't turn a single vote. Whereas most of the individual Republicans I know, business leaders, said, of course we want to invest in infrastructure. To me, that means the party's kind of broken. And if Trump comes close, I'm worried that it stays broken.
And you're talking about your state legislature.
Yes, my state legislature, yes.
Yeah. So let me just jump in and take it a little bit further. I also believe that we need a viable two-party system, and either party needs to be able to win the presidency from time to time. But I also think there's another illness that took hold in the United States following the 2010 election, and that is that gerrymandering of districts reached a high point in modern America. You would have to go back to post-Civil War America to find maps the likes of which have been drawn post-2010, which means that in so many districts, if you're a Republican, you only worry about being challenged from further on the right. And in many districts, if you're a Democrat, you only are concerned about being challenged from further on the left. And that's just not good for America. You know, the map should represent who we are and what we are. Pennsylvania, a state the Democrats haven't lost in, you know, what, going back to the 80s? You have seven more Republican congressmen than you have Democrat congressmen. The maps after the Democrats took a huge beating in the 2010 election and on a state-by-state basis, were drawn in such a way, and we were flat-footed. We didn't go to court quickly enough. We didn't compel other actions. We weren't paying attention. Quite frankly, we didn't even talk about it in the 2010 cycle, what was going to happen if certain things happened. And I have a long-term goal of making sure that fair maps are drawn after the next census is taken so that the founders had a good idea. The House should represent where America is on any given day by a recent election. And the Senate should be the more deliberative body. But now we've drawn maps up that don't allow that to happen.
But that's a state issue. What could Connecticut do?
Well, Connecticut, you know, it's funny. We have 35 states in America where governors play a role in redistricting. 35. Connecticut's not one of them. But 35 states, if we had won a few more, if we hadn't lost the governorship in Michigan or Ohio or Wisconsin or Pennsylvania, the maps that were drawn in those states wouldn't have been drawn that way. So I think, quite frankly, you know, you mentioned I was the head of the DGA. I want more Democratic governors in office when the next census is drawn so that somebody can at least force the maps that are get drawn by what will be overwhelmingly state Republican legislatures, that at least somebody's there to throw it to the courts.
Well, shouldn't this be taken out of the hands of partisan elected officials?
Well, what I would say to you there is
both parties have an interest.
And I'll reference, we got caught flat-footed. We didn't go to court when we should have gone to court as quickly as we did. So we have, since the last census and some of the post 2011 adjustments, we've won the battle in Florida. We've won the battle in North Carolina. We've won the battle in Virginia, at least with the adjustments of some of those districts. I think the courts will play a more active role if we can get it to the courts sooner in the process. And that's a long-term goal for me.
So, Governor Hickenlooper, gerrymandering is one cause of this partisan, poisonous divide that's hit us in the past 20 years. What are the other causes?
Closely allied to gerrymandering would be this, having the extreme parts, having so few people involved in your primaries that the extreme wing of both parties basically determines who ends up in the ballot. And we have, for those of you that are Colorado voters, especially those of you who are engaged in politics and might write a check to support a really cleverly thought out ballot initiative. This year we have a couple ballot initiatives, but one is to create open primaries, very similar to what California enacted some years ago. And ultimately it'll take time, but ultimately I'm quite confident this is going to allow independents, when they go up and before an election, and they will be able to decide, are they going to vote as a Republican or a Democrat this time? And in that primary now, it doesn't change their registration. I mean, they'll be able to still go back to what they were, but it's going to allow us to have much more, the probabilities that we'll have much more moderate people on the ballots, you know, that win the primaries. And that's a good thing. If you...
So let me join that discussion for a minute. I also think that there are some very smart politicians who get to pick out issues that they know will work for them. So if you look at gay, lesbian, transgender rights, everyone in this room needs to understand, if you have that conversation with anybody under the age of 28, they don't even know what you're talking about, why you would even engage in a discussion about whether you're going to treat people fairly, regardless of their identification and who they love. Then you get to another group where it's 50-50, and then you get to another group, a heavily voting group, particularly in southern states, that says, "Hey, we're gonna win an election on that issue." And it's not just that issue; it's on union rights that have been used in many states to divide us. It's on voting rights. You know, smart folks have gone out and convinced people in America that we have a fraudulent voting problem in America. Now, there's not an independent study anywhere in any state that supports that we have a fraudulent voting problem in America. None, zero, zip. And yet, more than 30 states have had bills enacted that limit people's voting rights, with the argument that we have to make sure that no one can fraudulently vote. It doesn't exist, but somebody is winning elections on it. And this kind of divide and conquer, I'm going to go back to Trump for a second. Listen, I'm 61 years old. I'm a history buff. When I was a kid and when I was a young adult, I would read as much as I could, and I always wondered, how did the things that happened in Europe post-1918 happen? How could that, these are smart people, how could that possibly have transpired? There was nothing in my American experience or knowledge that gave me a way of understanding that as I tried to process that in high school and college and thereafter. And then this year came along. And in that light, and other things that have happened over the last 5 or 6 or 10 years. I mean, people that would deny that Barack Obama had an American mother, which guaranteed that he was an American citizen no matter where he was born and what country his father was born in. You thread these things together, and all of a sudden you find a way to divide enough people to conquer them. And we've got to be careful about that in America, but it's very effective politics.
One other issue. Both of your states, whether it was Newtown, Connecticut, or Aurora, Colorado, have faced sort of the crazed person who gets weapons. You've talked about homegrown terrorists, which have now, we've seen what happens in Orlando and San Bernardino. What should be done about gun control, Governor?
Well, obviously, I mean, universal background checks, I've said that on this stage for the last, I think, 4 years or 5 years. No one I know and who's a responsible business leader opposes background checks. So that's step zero. We should have universal background checks nationwide. Then you go on to the next steps of, you know, the more difficult battles are, you know, the size of the capacity of magazines or really just going out and outright banning assault weapons. And there are arguments against that. There are so many assault weapons out there already that you're not going to really see an effect for a generation or two. That's the argument, that just for those guns, you're going to grandfather them in, those guns are going to be in cycle for a long period of time. I don't think that negates the argument, right? That even if it takes a long time for the process to occur, that's no reason not to take on that political battle. I do know that it is will be a bitter battle over adjusting any of these gun rights. But we did it before, right? They got rid of sawed-off shotguns in the 1930s during the Depression because it was used in bank robberies. You could hold a whole bank hostage with a shotgun with buckshot. You know, buckshot is named because it's big enough pellets it'll kill a buck, right? I mean, and when you put it in a sawed-off shotgun, it can you know, over 20 feet, it can span out about 10 feet wide. So you can do a lot of damage with a couple rounds. But we banned it, and we banned the machine gun. After, you know, the Tommy guns, it was all through, you know, John Dillinger and all that stuff. They were being used to terrorize us. And I think we're getting close to the point where people are beginning to think that assault weapons, these are tools meant solely, not for hunting or any other sport, but solely for the killing of human beings, that maybe we shouldn't have so many of those in circulation.
So in Connecticut, you can't buy them, nor can you buy a magazine, high capacity. And the folks who had them prior to that time had to register them and declare them, both on the capacity of the magazine and the weapon itself. And understand that those weapons couldn't be sold in the United States until 2004. This is a recent phenomenon, not an old phenomenon. It's a recent creation of a problem. And then if you look at the most recent mass murders or shootings, or the 8 out of the top 10, they all involve those particular weapons. And then if you look at street crime, particularly on the eastern seaboard, and there are lots of folks here from the eastern seaboard, 95 is the distribution system for guns that are purchased in states that don't do background checks. We do universal background checks in Connecticut on every gun purchase required, even on over the internet. You're committing a crime and can be prosecuted if you don't do a background check. But they come up from states where they still have gun show loopholes. Listen, folks, most Americans think we have universal background checks. That's why 90% agree that we should have them, because over 50% think we already do. That's the reality of that situation. And most Americans think that most gun purchases are subject to background checks, when 42% of guns being sold in the United States today will not be subject to a background check. That's who we are, and that's what we are, and we better change. I said after Newtown, a couple of days in frustration, that we're going to make changes, and a lot of states have, including our two states and other states. We're going to make those changes because, you know, an Aurora-type shooting or a Newtown-type shooting or a community college-type shooting in Oregon, and I could go down the list because I've studied a lot of these things. They're coming to your neighborhood. That's what we've done to America, and we better wake up. And the most dangerous gun to be used, the most dangerous gun to be used in the next 72 hours is the gun that's purchased today.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So the other thing, just to finish, and I've said this before here in Aspen, that the universal background checks, we went back to the year 2012 when we took up the debate in 2013, and we'd gotten to half the gun purchases, and we went back and said, well, all our Republican elected leaders said, you're not really, crooks aren't stupid, you're not going to catch anyone. Why are you making everyone spend $10 and wait around 15 minutes to get a background check? And in 2012, getting to half the gun purchases, there were 38 people convicted of homicide who tried to buy a gun. We stopped them. 133 people convicted of sexual assault. There were 620 burglars, 1,300 people convicted of felony assault. 420 people had a judicial restraining order that they couldn't see their ex-spouse or ex-boss, and they tried to buy a gun, and we stopped them. And last but not least, there were 238 people, when they came to pick up their new gun, we arrested them for an outstanding warrant for a violent crime. I mean, how can you argue against something that does that?
On criminal justice reform, you've now taken the lead. I think you call it the second opportunity.
Second chance.
Second chance law.
Well, I'm a former prosecutor. I was an assistant district attorney in Brooklyn, New York in the early 1980s. I tried 23 felony cases. I had convictions in 22 of those cases. I am not soft on crime. What America has done to itself has been wrong on crime for a long period of time. We have become more convinced in permanent and support permanent punishment as opposed to permanent reformation. And we've got to change who we are. And you know, most of us, most of the people in this room don't live in true urban environments. But how do you turn a city around where 15 to 20% of the population for a mistake made under the age of 25 is deemed to be unemployable or at least can't get a good job? How do you do that? And that's what we've done to ourselves. And so I'm trying to have a national discussion about let's change our approach to criminal justice. Let's put a lot of time and effort into making sure that we don't send people, young people to jail because we're frustrated with them. And I'm telling you that that's what happens in a lot of courts, because some kid will come in and they'll do something wrong and they'll do something wrong again, and particularly if he's black or Hispanic, he'll do something a third time. And out of frustration, rather than assigning a social worker, rather than doing other things, well, you know, 30, 60, 90, 126 months a year in jail is going to do him some good. You know what that does? It gives you an advanced degree in criminal behavior. And we are giving out far too many degrees in criminal behavior, far more, I think, in many of our urban environments than otherwise. Part of that's got to be bail reform. People should not be kept in jail because they're poor. And I am telling you that in Connecticut, on any given day, anywhere between 300 and 500 people are held in prison or jail awaiting trial for as little as $1. In one case, when we did a survey, the vast majority for as little as $250, they remain in jail. We now know statistically in the United States that if you spend 8 to 14 days in jail awaiting trial, your outcome changes dramatically. Not just your outcome in the case that you're in jail on, your lifetime projection. Because if you had a job, you lost it. If you had an apartment, usually living in a single room occupancy, somebody else is already living there. If you had a support network, it's gone. So we really have to look at, do we want to permanently punish young people when they're now when they're 40 because they bought or purchased or sold some small amount of marijuana? One of the first things we did was decriminalize. We haven't done what Colorado did.
You'll get there.
Not on my watch, not on my watch.
That's what Governor Hickenlooper said, too.
And so now we're going back, and, you know, we had one other story I'll tell you. Lots of states in the 80s and 90s passed laws that if you sold drugs within 1,500 feet or 2,000 feet of a school or a daycare facility or a nursing home or public housing, that you had a mandatory sentence. We did that in Connecticut. So I started to put maps together. There was one place you could sell drugs in New Haven. Mm-hmm. One place that you could sell drugs in New Haven that we could identify that you weren't automatically, if you possessed drugs or sold drugs, didn't face a potential jail sentence.
Speaking of which, Governor, have your opinions changed on decriminalization of marijuana, or legalization of it?
They have. And I do want to echo just for a moment, I think what the work that Dan is doing in Connecticut, and we're doing similar work, I think all of us, and Mitch Daniels famously said that, you know, he wanted Indiana to be the worst place to commit a violent crime and the best place to get a second chance. Mm-hmm. And I think that notion that every human can be rehabilitated is the aspiration we should start with, not to say that we should be foolish, but that we should really put more resources, more effort into rehabilitation before people come out. We used to, when someone caused trouble, we put them in solitary confinement. They called it administrative segregation, which is a total, you know, nonsense, right? And these people were too dangerous to have in the prison yard, and they'd finish their 9 years, of which the last 7 years, most of them have some mental health issue, so the worst thing you can do is put them in solitary confinement, and then we would release them directly from solitary confinement back into society with no transition period at all. No wonder we have so many violent outcomes and so many dreadful problems with parole and that entire system. So I think what Dan is, and he's really kind of working on a more national level on this, but he's on the right spot. Marijuana, woohoo! Marijuana was, I fought it just because we almost every elected official in the state of Colorado fought it. I can count on one hand the number of people I know that thought this was going to be a good idea, because you're going to be in conflict with federal law. And plus you got to create a regulatory environment that's never been done before, right? Amsterdam never legalized and taxed it. They just decriminalized it, which many, many communities have done, and that's certainly a great step. So we fought it. It passed 55-45. Well, when your citizens say that's what they want, I think as a governor, you do the very best you can. And we got a young man named Andrew Friedman from Denver. He'd gone to school back east, got a Harvard law degree. He was 28 years old, and we made him our marijuana czar. He hates that term, let me say. But he knows more about marijuana regulation than probably anybody else in the United States right now. And we went from ground zero, and he and myself, there were about six or eight of us that helped kind of design a process by which we would have all the stakeholders in the room together and try to figure out how do we visualize what the problems are going to be in 5 years or 10 years, and try, by anticipating them, avoid them. And you know, it hasn't been perfect. I think edibles, we could not get on top of edibles quickly enough. Obviously, we have an industry now, but even back then, the industry had some real money behind it and had some powerful lobbyists. So it took us a while to now, you know, they would have eight doses in one large brownie. We had all kinds of kids in the hospital and adults in the hospital. We've got most of that. You can't sell gummy bears laced with THC anymore in Colorado. I mean, we've regulated an awful lot of that stuff. Yeah, I mean, it has been a battle because you have all these different points of contention. But I will tell you, we are now beginning to see, and we don't have strong data, but we have strong anecdotal evidence from several places that we're beginning to see less drug dealers. So, I mean, in terms of people say, well, other states should do it because you make all this tax money. Well, we made last year about $125 million, real money, but on a state budget of $27 billion, $125 million doesn't look that big. But it does allow us to, the first $40 million goes to school buildings, and the rest of it we have been rigorous in making sure it's being used for the consequences of marijuana legalization. So drug addictions, the kids that do fall off the tracks and, you know, get into bipolar disorder in a very, very bad way, even become schizophrenic, that's hard to find resources for. And that was the part we were most worried. We have not seen a spike in teenage usage. We have not seen a spike in general public usage, right? People who were smoking pot before it was legal, still are. The folks that weren't smoking it before it was legal, still don't. Most people who tried it in college found that there were other, better ways to look stupid to their friends and their family. I'm just kidding for you pot smokers out there. But I come back to the drug dealers, and actually it was one of John Buxbaum's kids I was meeting with out here two and a half years ago, and I asked, he was I think 17 at the time, I think it was Max, and I asked, are you worried, or should I be worried, that by we legalizing it, more teenagers are gonna think it's okay to smoke marijuana? And he looked at me dead in the face, and then he burst into laughter. And he says, I'm not trying to be disrespectful, but if you think that any 14 or 15-year-old who wanted to smoke pot thought it was harmful or couldn't get it, you're living in a dream, right? Anybody who wanted it could get it and tried it or smoked it. But if you regulate it properly and you get the taxing right, so that basically there's not the risk of someone selling into the black market is not worth whatever little profit they can make. You really pinch that profit away, you're going to end up getting rid of the black market in pot, which means you're getting rid of roughly half the total drug market. And so imagine any product group that you're going to all of a sudden cut in half, you're going to end up with a lot less salespeople. And Max looked at me and says, let me tell you, drug dealers don't care who they sell it to, right? And if you're worried about teenagers, and we are, you know, when your brain's growing rapidly, if you're a teenager, high THC marijuana is almost certainly reducing your long-term memory forever. It's almost universally accepted by every brain scientist I've talked to, and I think I've talked to most of them, that this is a very high probability. Well, get rid of the drug dealers then. And now we're beginning to see places where we always had drug dealers, and now they're saying they don't see them.
Mm-hmm. Let me just go back. There is a economic imperative to reexamining our criminal justice approach, and that is that it is costing us billions of dollars to incarcerate people for nonviolent offenses across our country. I mean, in Connecticut now, it's about $138 a night So when I tell you that we have had all those people in jail overnight because they couldn't make as little as a dollar bail, and most of them couldn't make as little as $250, if you're a Connecticut citizen, and I said hello to a few, it's costing you about $138 a night for us to keep them in jail because they can't make $250 bail. Think about that for a nonviolent offense. But I also, there's really a good side to this. Our prison population in Connecticut is now 28%, about 28% smaller than it was in 2008. By the way, my predecessors added 10,000 beds to the prison system. So now we're 28% smaller. We have a smarter approach to criminal justice and who should go to jail and who should not and how long they should stay and what skill set they should work on while they're there. And we have better drug and alcohol treatment plans for them. We have better mental health plans for them. We have sessions 6 months to 18 months to get people who have been in jail for a long period of time ready to go back to society. Our crime with a much smaller prison population is at a 48-year low. And in 2014, our violent crime in Connecticut dropped over 2.5 times the national average drop. And this year, shootings are down as much as 40% in our largest cities. So, I mean, a smarter approach on the long term will make a lot of sense. I want to share one statistic. I want to go back to this youth. And part of it is, you know, drug issues, as simple as marijuana, or perhaps more, a little bit deeper. But one of the things we've done in Connecticut is take down the number of people under the age of 21 who are in our incarceration system by something approaching 52-54%. So I asked the corrections commissioner to do a study, and I wanted to know what percentage of our prison population in Connecticut had been incarcerated before the age of 21. It was 75%.
Wow.
Think about it. So if we can make that kind of cut in that relatively short period of time, what hopefully that projects out into the future. We need to keep people out of jail. Certain people have to go to jail. Don't get me wrong. I sent a lot of them away. But a whole bunch of people never should go to jail. And we should spend our money more wisely in making it easier for them to recover from their anxiety, depression are really two of the biggest reasons people end up in jail.
And then
drug and alcohol addiction is right up there as well. That's not a reason to send somebody to jail, nor is poverty.
Mm-hmm. My last question, I'm going to open it up after this, sort of follows through. In dealing with poverty, both of you have tried a two-generational approach. It comes from something that Ann Mosley at the Aspen Institute and her Ascend program have been doing. Explain how a two-generational approach has worked and how you would, you know, implement it.
Well, I think, so to understand two-generational, it is if you're providing services to someone in the family, you probably need to provide services to everybody in the family. I mean, just think about it. If you have a mother who's addicted, well, she's got a problem. She may have a spouse that has a problem because of her addiction. She may have a child who has a problem because of that addiction. You may even have a grandmother who has to take over the parenting responsibilities because of that addiction. You need to treat all of those people. You need to provide services to everybody. And here's another area where we've had great success in our Department of Children and Families, where we are a lot of our moms and dads who we have to play a role in supervising or even taking children out of households have drug problems. So what we are now funding with some grants and finding money, hopefully saving it in the right places, is that if we provide an ongoing home visitation program that is supportive of recovery, the recovery rate increases by 42%.
Saves you money.
Saves you money. And that has an impact on the child in the house, on the mom, on the ability to hold down a job or a part-time job, if that's important to supporting the family, all of that. And it's that holistic intergenerational approach that I think is going to produce the best results over the next 10 or 20 years. And it is a break with the past. It really is a break. It sounds too simple, right, to think that this is a big new idea. It's a big new idea. And the Aspen Institute has been a part of that. One of my commissioners was in your Ascend program on this particular issue, and we're invested. We call it 2-gen, but we're invested on a 3-gen thing. Well, let me also share one other thing to you. If you have to take a child out of a home, placing it with a family member is far more leads to more success than placing it with somebody who's not a family member, and that's another version of 2-gen. So you know, place it with a grandma, or granddad, or a close cousin, or an uncle or an aunt, and more times than not, you're going to have a better outcome.
Did you want to add anything, or should we?
Just the work the NEKC Foundation did on that is so powerful, and then also my former chief of staff, Roxanne White, when she left a year and a half ago, she became the CEO of what's called Nurse Family Partnerships. And this is a 2-gen approach from the bottom up, whereby nurses who go visit expectant mothers 6 months before birth in low-income families, low-income neighborhoods, not only examine the prospective mother for her health, but also begin teaching that mother, who often, almost in the vast majority of times, is a teenage mother, oftentimes not married, oftentimes not in a stable family situation, starts teaching that expectant mother how to be a mother. And so when that nurse, you keep the same nurse, comes back with 3 months before birth, is there immediately after birth or sometimes during birth, and then follows up at the well baby checkups 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, and constantly talking about reading to your child and doing all the basic stuff that many of us take for granted, and it is very powerfully successful in terms of a dollar on reward. The other thing I wanted to point out, that your prisoners are $138 a day. Yeah. We're $53 in college. What are you feeding them?
All right, let me, I've spent too much time, so let me, we'll add 10 more minutes and have questions here.
First of all, I'd love to get a pair of those socks. I don't
know. Yeah, it's a little, I'll get you the name. It's a little retail store in Grand Junction.
But they actually have Bernie Sanders socks, too.
Yeah, they have Bernie Sanders, and they have Hillary socks, of course.
I'd like to ask both governors to discuss the level of unfunded OPEB in each of their states, what the per capita unfunded OPEB is, and what percentage you report and how realistic it is.
Governor Malloy, I think we were talking about that in my office. I said nobody would ask you that.
OPEB is other post-employment benefits, and until I became governor, employees didn't contribute. They do now. And quite frankly, we're going to have to build a system that's more supportive of the OPEB benefits that have previously been negotiated.
Are they underfunded in Connecticut?
They were unfunded. You can't be more underfunded than being unfunded.
They are unfunded, and the question is, what is the per capita?
Yeah, I don't. You know, I don't remember, and I remember a lot of things, but I don't remember the per capita cost. But it choke a horse.
You're going to get this under control.
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah. I you know, listen, we have made substantial progress. We've, you know, in negotiations with the state unions in 2011, we negotiated about $21 billion in savings. But that's a fraction of the unfunded portion of both our pension and OPEB obligations. But most of that savings was in OPEB, because we now have employees' mandatory contribution, which didn't exist before I became governor. But this is a problem. It has to be dealt with. It doesn't get fixed overnight. And to put things in worse shape, you know, our pension system was only 42% funded when I became governor. So,
but that's
That's reported, right?
Yeah.
No, let me let Governor Hickenlooper.
Well, you all can have a private sidebar afterwards.
We might have different approaches, yeah. but I absolutely agree with you. And somebody who's been in the trenches arguing that case with some success, you know, employees don't want to give up the benefit. And if the choice is, do you contribute to it on an ongoing basis or for a portion of your employment, mm-hmm. And keep it, or you give it up, then I think we can win that argument.
So, and it's a shame that Gina Raimundo, who's the governor of Rhode Island, isn't here, because she is probably, I think, the best governor, Republican or Democrat, to really address this in a state where that's she's actually underwater in terms of approval ratings right now because she has been so strong on this. But it is a story that needs to be told. Colorado is so far out of balance in reported and unreported that the Republicans and Democrats created a compromise in, I think it was 2006, where staged up through to 2020, and then for 25 years after that, the state would take a larger and would contribute a larger match of the employees' pay, and that this would be split between the employee and the state. So it goes up to 20%. So what happens is just think about it. So we pay someone $50,000 a year. That means 20%, the $10,000 goes into the pension to try and make it whole, of which half of that's supposed to come out of so we're now underpaying by $5,000 on it for a $40,000 a year job. That's 16%. So it makes managing the enterprise much harder if you're really going to do this accurately, and we tried to do it. And even with that, because they have these unrealistic high expectations of what the corpus will return, we are still far out of balance from where we have to be. The one saving grace is if you look at one of the levers that's there is the COLA, the cost of living adjustment that happens every year, and our COLA for years was 3%. That has an immense consequence when you change that. So we had moved ours back down to, I think it's 1.75 now. I think that's right. And what we're now looking at is how do we measure when we're so far out of compliance that we have to move the COLA down? Because, of course, you can imagine everyone in the pension system really is against that. And that's a very loud voice. They're voters, they're seniors, very difficult group to really try to speak, give them the real facts and get them to come to a consensus. But by doing a trigger and saying, all right, if in occasion when this occurs, we're going to adjust this COLA for 2 years or for 4 years, you get big consequences. But I think I think we can get there get the pension community to sign off on that.
A couple of quick questions, and I hope, yes, the woman on the way back, or, yeah.
Thank you. Hi, thank you. First of all, thank you very much for sharing your time with us here. You were talking a little bit about some of the things that led to the Trump phenomenon. And one of the things that everybody talks about is this level of anger that nobody had really understood was coming to a head. But people deal with anger in lots of different ways. And I'm wondering if we've missed an opportunity to talk about public discourse, talk about civil discourse, to talk about how we teach our children, maybe some non-cognitive skills to focus on in education, and how we deal with bullying in childhood and growing up such that we don't end up with the kind of adult behavior that we're seeing.
Governor
now.
Malloy.
So if we're going to begin with a child, I nominate Trump. So listen to your words. I mean, the behaviors he is exhibiting are those kinds of behaviors that show up very much earlier in life than at the age of 70. And you have to wonder about an America that gets excited about somebody who yells, "You're fired," 12 times a season. So I mean, I think yeah, there is a we have to have a broader conversation. But right now, I'm going to concentrate on the election.
Governor Hickenlooper.
And I would say that what matters is the number of times an entrepreneur says you're hired rather than you're fired.
Yeah.
Sorry. I know. I couldn't agree more. I will say, Colorado is a local school district controlled system. But we have anti-bullying programs and, again, real serious approaches to how, to conflict resolution and getting kids to, at a much earlier age. We're talking in elementary school and middle school to beginning to be in conflict and work it out successfully. So it's in the larger school districts. We're working to get it everywhere, but I couldn't agree more.
Yeah. It's also a two-generation mm-hmm. problem.
Yes, right there. Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm.
Hi, I'm Carol Puckett, and what I'd like to ask is, what role do you think that racism is playing in this deep anger and frustration and divide in the election?
Bigger than anyone thinks. I mean, I think racism continues to be a major, you know, it's the wallpaper on the walls of the room, any room we go in. I mean, I just think that we just haven't dealt with it in America, even after, no one ever questioned the legitimacy of a white president the way they did of a black president. And not enough of us, and some of us did, but not enough of us stood up and said, that's out and out racism. And it was. I mean, again, I'll just give you the facts. No one doubted that the mother was born in Kansas and was an American citizen when she had a child. The child was an American citizen, and yet we had a debate led by a candidate for president right now about whether that person was a legitimate president of the United States, and we never had that conversation about a white man before. So
Governor,
it's a big issue.
Governor, yeah.
I think there are a number of followers of Donald Trump. And I think a better way to frame it is that that notion of a multicultural society, as the United States being a melting pot, they think is being challenged, and they don't think that people are melting, and they feel that there are, you know, they think it's a salad bowl, and that people aren't, that we're not becoming the melting pot, and then they're very upset by it, and it frustrates and angers them. Racism is a hard edge. And in many cases it applies, is a hard-edged word, but it is this frustration that we're not the place that people used to think. And we've gone through these cycles before, the know-nothings that Dan referred to before. We've had, where you have a high rate of immigration over a period of years, it becomes very difficult to digest, for the people that are already here, to digest that level of change.
I want to say one other thing, and I have to say it, and I don't think you can separate racism from the things that are being said about our Muslim brothers and sisters in this country. And in 2010, this is not this year phenomenon. In 2010, we had people run for governor in states on the basis that they would pass constitutional amendments that said Sharia law could not be the law of that state. Now, Sharia law can't be the law of any state under any circumstances because we have something called the Constitution of the United States. And let there be no doubt, and it goes back to something I said earlier, people are really smart about picking issues that will divide people, and nothing divides people quite as much as race and religion, and people use it all the time to win elections.
I'm sorry, I've missed this side of the room. Questions? Yes, ma'am, right here. Mm-hmm. Oh, get two questions, because I did pick the woman behind you, but you now have the mic. So a quick question, and then I'll let her ask one as well. Go ahead.
Real quick. In this session, you have given a lot of facts about voting irregularities that really don't exist, issues about automatic weapons and the effect on the killings that we've seen. We hear this, we'll hear it on MSNBC, we'll hear it at gatherings like this. It's like the preachers talking to the choir.
Right.
The problem is that all the people that are at the Trump rallies that we see on TV shouting, lock her up, or for Obama's, when he was running, you know, he's not a citizen. Those people are from an educational and background level that don't watch MSNBC, don't attend things like this. So why don't we hear the facts that you've been giving us presented in the political campaign presentation.
Yeah, we got your question. Let me ask the woman behind you to also throw hers in, and we'll wrap it up with, you know, closing thoughts.
Okay. First of all, I want to thank both of you gentlemen for your enlightened presentations and for being here. I'm sorry that my governor was not able to make it. I would like for him to have heard all this. I suppose that he would have had something to contribute. But Governor Hickenlooper, you used the word framing just a moment ago, and that brought to my mind all the political framing that's being done in order to make these nasty arguments that we're having now. And nobody touches on that, but it appears over and over again.
Let me combine those two with what the question back there, the first half, which we didn't answer, which is just elevating our political discourse and trying to heal this poison we have in our society. After this election, what should we be doing about that? Let me ask both of you to end with that type of closing.
So, and framing and context do matter tremendously, and the legitimate question of why certain media choose not to give the basic facts and present a very contorted view of, or a twisted view of what the real facts are. I mean, those are complex issues that are, I don't think we have the time to go into them, and especially that notion of balance, of why don't we have a higher level of discourse. But I think one thing that we haven't talked about before is corporate money in politics that's unbridled, and I don't mean this as a political one way or the other, because there are some very wealthy Democrats as well as very wealthy, Republican corporations that are in this game, and also the attack ads. And the attack ads work; they diminish product categories, and we're diminishing the product category of democracy. People are turning it off and tuning out, especially young people, and the solution to it is really hard. And part of it is going to the media themselves and trying to convince them. And I've been doing this, that they have a self-interest. You look at newspapers, my God, most big city newspapers are barely alive. And part of it is they go along, and TV stations, the old broadcast news, they go along and accept these attack ads. They're part of their media corporation revenue, and they make people turn off, tune out, and that diminishes the media's reach. In other words, less people are paying attention to the basic issues and the news and the issues around society. And American democracy, I think, is the best system there is, but it's pretty darn fragile. And it is dependent upon people taking the time to be empathetic, to think of what's best for someone you'll never know, but also to understand the real facts and the issues. And if we can't convince the media that they have a self-interest, I think then we do. It's hard to figure out a solution.
Governor Malloy, closing thoughts.
I'm going to try to weave a couple of things. Answering to those points that were made, I think the census, the election of 2010, the census of 2010, the redistricting of 2011 was a much more serious impingement on our liberties and our freedoms than we had previously calculated. And when you're able to gerrymander state house after state house, state senate after state senate, and the Congress of the United States, having a discourse that it doesn't run to the right has become very, very, very difficult. And I blame myself for not paying enough attention to it. And I think this is a very serious issue, because if the Congress of the United States is never again going to be in play, then we're going to have a real hard time restoring the kind of discourse that needs to take place and did take place in the United States for most of our existence. Not always happily, not always easily. I do think that there are issues like religious hatred and racism that although we've made progress, I think, there's still a long way to go. I mean, I love you all, but almost everybody here is white. Most of the low-paying jobs being filled in the United States today are going to Black and Hispanic people, and the jobs that are being filled by people that are not likely to see increases in pay, that's where they're going, folks. So we've got big issues as believers in democracy. We still have big issues. We can all be pioneers if we stand up and be counted.
I know there are a lot of other questions. I invite you to come forward for more informal discussion. Thank you, Governor. Thank you, Governor.